On this third Sunday of Advent, as we think about the coming of Jesus Christ, we light the candle of joy. When Christ comes into our lives, he brings a fullness of joy. In Isaiah 61, it says,
he anoints our hearts with the oil of gladness and gives us a garment of praise instead of a faint spirit.
When Jesus was born, the angel said that his coming was good news of great joy for all people. Luke 2:10.
Because Christ has come to us, we can live every day in the joy of the Lord. Praise to his name.
Amen.
How do you follow that? Stand and sing with me. Every day with Jesus is sweeter than the day before. You believe that?
Amen.
Amen.
Found the
Isn't that a reason to be joyful?
Amen.
The Lord is coming. He's coming back.
Yes,
coming back before we know it. It's getting closer every day. God's getting closer to sending his son to see us. Reach us and take us back home. Hallelujah. It is joy unspeakable. All right. Joy to the world.
The Lord for that. Aren't you thankful for that?
Amen.
Man, I love that third verse of that psalm. Man, it's an awesome verse. No more let sin or sorrow grow, right? Amen.
Right. Amen.
Amen. And then I love the tag on it, for as the curse is found,
yes,
right? Sin's cursed. It's wherever it may be, Jesus trumps every bit of that. Man, praise the Lord for that. Well, this morning as we go to the Lord in prayer, all that would just gathering around, and we're going to continue to lift up our praises, but also we're going to lift up our prayers to him as well. I know we have friends and loved ones that are sick, friends and loved ones that are lost, and so we want to pray for them and lift them up, trusting the Lord for how good he is and what he can do for them and for us as well. And so let's just reach out this morning. Touch the hem of his garment. Lord Jesus, right now we come before you and we thank you for how good you are. Lord, we're thankful that this morning we can sing the words, joy to the world, the Lord has come. Lord, thank you for that. And I pray that you just continue to bless us today, Lord, as we have come. We have come, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, because you are still the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. And though you came as a babe in a manger, Lord Jesus, you truly are the Savior of the world. And so we pray today, would you help us? Help us, Lord, as we sing. Help us, Lord, as we pray. Help us, Lord, as we lift up our praises to you and to who you are. Because, Lord, we know that you can do all things and you do all things well. Lord, you would tell us in your word, we have not because we ask not. And Lord, I pray that you would help us this morning as we ask. We don't ask for the wrong reason. We ask because we know that you love us enough. You care about us enough. That, Lord, you are concerned about our hearts, the desires of our heart, the places that we are. And so we ask, Lord, would you just touch today in a mighty way? Lord, thank you for each one that is here. Thank you, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that we get this opportunity to share with each other. And that, Lord, you're going to speak as you already have through our songs. Lord, you're going to continue to do that, Lord, as we continue on in this service. And so we pray, Lord, have your way today. I ask, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, there's a lot of sickness that's going on. But, Lord Jesus, right now, would you begin to touch? Would you begin to right now just continue to move in such a mighty way? And I pray, Lord, that as you bind the wounds, that as you continue to put the salve, the balm that is needed upon that, I pray, Lord, would the healing come. I pray, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, that you just continue to help us. Lord, as today we seek you, we seek your face. We seek the throne, Lord Jesus, that one day we will bow down before. And Lord, we do that today. We lift up our voices. And Lord, we pray, would you save our lost loved ones? Would you save our lost friends and our neighbors? We pray, dear Heavenly Father, would even at this very moment, Lord, would you speak to them in only the way the Holy Spirit can speak and prick the heart. We pray, Lord, that that this morning something would be said just even around them, even if they're not here, that something around them would be said, would be spoken, would be sung, would be anyway, that, Lord, it would point to you, and the reason for the season is all about Jesus Christ. And so I pray today, would you do that? Help us, dear Heavenly Father, Lord, in the remainder of our time that we have here today, we ask, dear Heavenly Father, pour out your anointing. We love you and we praise you for all that you do. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen and amen. Praise the Lord. You may be seated.
The little Lord Jesus laid down his sweet head. The stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the by me forever and love me, I pray. Bless all the dear children in thy tender care and fit us for heaven to live with thee there. So
Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright, round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild. Whose feet the shepherds fall? Who is he in deep distress, fasting in the wilderness? 'Tis the Lord, a wondrous story. 'Tis the Lord, the King of glory. At his feet we humbly fall. Crown him, crown. Who is he that from the grave came to heal and help and save? Who is he that from his throne rules through all the world alone? 'Tis the Lord, a wondrous story. 'Tis the Lord, the King of glory. At his feet we humbly fall. Crown him, crown him, Lord of all. 'Tis the Lord, a wondrous story. 'Tis the Lord, the King of glory. At his feet we humbly fall. Crown him, crown him, Lord of all.
Have you crowned him today? Man. The thing about it is this. He's Lord of all, whether you crown him or not. Right? We can't take his crown. He's already crowned. Yeah, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Well, this morning the children can be dismissed to go to children's church. They are going to have a good time back there today. Lord's going to bless them. Toddler's church is ready. I think the nursery's ready as well. So we praise the Lord for that. Yeah. Are you enjoying the Christmas season? Right? It's a season, right? It is a season. Now, the thing about it is seasons come and go. But in Christianity, this is year-long. Praise the Lord. I know we celebrate the Savior's birth on a day. We do that. But the thing about it, it's year-long. It's year-long. Praise the Lord for that. This morning, Matthew chapter 2, if you have your Bibles with you, Matthew chapter 2. Matthew chapter 2, and after you found that, if you would, stand out of reverence of God's word. And we'll be starting in the very first verse, Matthew chapter 2, verse 1. Word of the Lord says this: Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, Where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled in all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and the scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. Verse 5, they told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel.'" Verse 7. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him." I just seen if you are awake. Can you see that? You realize that's in the sense that he was doing this, right? That evil laugh was, okay, I'm the only one that heard it when I read it, buddy. Oh, me. Verse 9. After listening to the king and his evil laugh, they went on their way. That wasn't in there, by the way. And they went on their way. And behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. Verse 11. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And we'll stop there. Lord Jesus, thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, would you just continue to touch us today as we just have sung, and then as we heard it sang, the medley, Lord, that was right there. Thank you, Lord, for the words and the songs that bring out the scripture that truly you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and we can bow down before you. We love you, Lord. We praise you for all you do. I pray, Lord, would you help me today? Lord, I pray that you touch me. Lord, help me. I don't want any distractions in my mind, Lord. So I pray that you'd help me just focus upon your word. And so, Lord, I thank you for that. I thank you for how good you are. And, Lord, may your word go forth and not return void. We love you. We give you praise. We ask it in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. There's a song that is sung, and it says this: "Wise men still seek him." I love it. It's one of my favorites. It's a trio that can sing it, usually, is how it's done. Sometimes the whole choir can do it. But man, it's a very powerful song. And it says these words: "Wise men still seek him. Through the shadow of night, they search for a light of hope in Christ. And the darkness gives way to the light when wise men still seek him." Man, isn't that awesome? I like those words. This morning, I want to preach a message that's just going to be entitled this: "What Have You Brought?" So think about that, just in today's sense. What have you brought? You came today. What have you brought? And so here we see in this scripture passage that we read of the Christmas story. They're all wonderful. Luke is one of my favorite to read out of the Christmas story. But here we see the Christmas story also in Matthew after we come out of the genealogy of Jesus in chapter 1. And we see here in chapter 2, we pick up with the Christmas story of Jesus Christ's birth. There's still something about this time of year, as we've talked about the last couple of Sundays, that draws people really even to church. Granted, we realize that numbers may be down all across the board, but the thing about it is this: there's still something about Christmas time. As much as the world has secularized it and as much as the world has pushed away, I just saw an article the other day. I don't believe very many things, right? So a lot of people say, "Are you from Missouri?" I'd say, "Probably," right? Just because somebody says something don't mean anything to me. Prove it. Prove it, right? Why did people tell me all the time, "I love Jesus"? Well, awesome. Now prove it. Prove it, right? That your words don't mean anything. My words don't mean anything until we prove that we truly love Jesus. Right? Means it. But the other day I saw this study that came out that says in America, people are leaving the Christian faith by droves. And I believe it. Because the church doesn't have a clue what they stand for anymore. And the world is saying, y'all are more lost than what we are. The world says, I'll try to find something else. We got so many denominations that they can't even define what a woman is. They can't define what a man is. And the world is like, I need somebody to give me some answers based on something that is solid. And even what sometimes the church is failing. And they're like, okay, we'll find something else, and they'll leave. I don't believe too many statistics. I believe that because all we got to do is look around. All we got to do is look around. We live in a sad time. We find that these wise men that we've talked about this morning as we read in this story, they came from the east. They came seeking so that they could worship. And I love how Matthew brings this out, is that there was a reason that they came. It wasn't just to come, right? To think about it, I've read through it, trying to find an ulterior motive of why they would have came. Could there have been something behind the scene that they didn't tell anybody the reason they wanted to be there? Could there have been just I wonder, did they just go just to stare? You know, a lot of people come to church just stare. I've got the bird's eye view because I'm up here and y'all are out there. You don't know who's looking at each other. Some of y'all could give a better detail of what a woman or a man is wearing than what I preached. Okay, I'll move on. Food's going to be great. Food. You got a joke that I can tell right now? Well, man. They came in this sense that they realized before they ever left, there was a reason they left. Think about that. Before they left to travel, there was a reason they left. They already knew what they were supposed to do. They didn't have to think. They didn't have a 30-minute, 45-minute drive to figure out if they really wanted to be at the place that they showed up to. It didn't take a week that they sat there and tried to figure out, is it really worth getting up that morning to go to a place of what we really want to do? Do we really want to do it? We do not see the wise man trying to figure out, do I need to flip a coin to figure out if I really want to go? It says that they went. What was the reason? It says they came to worship. Their whole way there, did you realize on their whole journey, what was on their mind? Their mind was this: we're on a mission to worship. Did you realize our mission as Christians? We are just preparing for what heaven will be. You do realize heaven's going to be a church service. Oh, it really is. And I'm as good as you all play. The music in heaven is going to be, right? Isn't that right, David? The music, they're good, right? Parker, where'd he go, man? He can hit on, I see you back there. Quit moving on me. But anyway, man. Music is great, but it ain't going to be nothing compared to heaven. Did you realize? How many of you all can sing? Some of y'all are scared to death. I'm going someplace with this. Now, how many of you all can't sing? You know what's going to happen when you get to heaven? Boy, it's going to sound good. It's going to sound good. But what? We practice down here what we're going to do for eternity there. We came to worship. Do we seek? we looking? Or are we trying to figure out what everybody else is doing? The wise men were not worried about what everybody else was doing. Their job was to find him and worship. Find him and worship. Look at verse 7 and 8. Look how far I jumped. Did you see that? She knows that. I skipped 6 verses. Aren't y'all proud? I mean, we're moving right along. Some would say I'm halfway done. That's probably not true. But I'm verse 7 and 8, man. Look at 7 and 8. We find that on a mission that they had to worship was trying to be interrupted. They had what? They knew what they were supposed to do, yet somebody tried to interrupt it. Does it make sense that on our journey that we have in our walk with Jesus, that there is someone trying to interrupt it? There's someone trying to say it's really not that important. Why don't you seek for something else? It probably won't be near as hard as what you're doing right now. Because right now, you're exerting a lot of energy. It takes a lot of your time, and you have to give up a lot of things. And so one will come along and say, why don't you find a different mission? Because really, in the end, it doesn't really matter what you did as long as you did it one time. And so if you sought him and you worshiped one time's good enough for all eternity. And so why not just worship the one time and then find a different mission, and every day of your life have a different mission, because that's what makes life fun. Because when you have something different that you're searching for or doing, man, it makes life more interesting, because then when you find it, then you're like, oh, I found it. Yet the wise men get here, and someone is trying to trip them up. And all of a sudden, we see here in verses 7 and 8, Herod would summon them, tried to figure out what was really going on. Now, and then tried to trick. What Satan's scheme from the beginning was to lie. Jesus, right? The father of lies. He's been a liar from the beginning. Father of all lies. And then we get to this place and we see that now King Herod begins to play a part in Satan's scheme. And King Herod begins to speak in a way that he would say, no, I want to worship him as well. And so if you will do all the work for me, because really I don't want to seek after him. I'd rather not do that part, because that really is too hard, takes too much time. I would rather you find him and then I figure out what else needs to be done. And so all of a sudden we see that, did you realize in our walk, seeking the Lord in the way that we should, finding what we're supposed to be finding, doing what we're supposed to be doing, Satan can send people, put them into our path to steal the joy that we have in what we're trying to find. Satan's always done the same thing. He'll never stop doing it. He's only got one thing: kill, steal, and destroy. There's nothing new. He's always done the same thing. John 10:10. And so we look at this and when we come to the realization Satan has no new tricks, it's always the same. Now we're better equipped with the word to be able to face what he's trying to bring at us, because I really want you to understand, Satan does not want you to have the joy that Jesus says that he can give. He wants you to bypass that, supplement it with something fake. And if you could supplement it with something fake, you do that every day of your life, and then your life doesn't seem old. I really want you to understand this. I meet people all the time that are always on a new journey. They're always on a new journey because they're afraid if they stay on the same journey that it'll get old and mundane and it won't be exciting, so they need to find something else. I've met people and I've dealt with people that they can't even stay married. because it's the same old journey, and they don't want the same old journey. They want something that's going to be different. They want something that's going to be fun. They want something that's going to be of the unknown. You see, I'm excited that I've been married to my wife for 63 years. Hey, now what? Ask her if she feels like it's been that long. You know what she told me the other day? We were talking about, so next, is it this month or next month? Next month? Next month? This month? This month. Sorry, let us have a conversation real quick. This month, it'll be what? I mean, let's just make sure you remember. This year be 21 years we've been together. So 21 years. Now what? Before you start clapping, you ain't talked to my wife. So what she says is this. She looked at me the other day. We was driving. And then she says, look at the road. And she said, you realize I've been with you over half my life. Oh, man. We started dating. As soon as she turned 17, we started dating. And she's 26 now. And so him. Oh, man. Thing about it is this. You see, we're on a journey together that a lot of people would say, man, how can y'all stand each other that long? Because it never gets old. My wife doesn't look at me and I don't look at her and say, man, we just, now she may say, you look old, but she didn't say we're getting old, right? Why? Because Jesus is at the center. And if Jesus is at the center, we ain't got to worry about anything getting old. So all of a sudden we see this. The Lord wants to put people in our path that extends our joy. Satan wants to put people in our path that takes our joy. And so God is always saying this, I have someone lined up for you. I have someone lined up for you. I have someone lined up for you. But watch this. The only way we can make sure that we know who is lined up for us, watch, even every single day of our life, the only way that we can know is if we're still on the same journey to do what we knew we needed, which is seek Him. You do realize every day you seek Him. It's not just I did it one time, that's good enough. If you only sought the Lord once, then you probably got a problem. Because it's every day of our life we seek Him because we want to know exactly what He wants for our lives. And I promise you, if you do every day of your life seeking Jesus to figure out what He wants for your life, it'll never get old. It'll never get old. It'll never get old. It's always good. Verse 9, watch this in verse 9. It says, after listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose went before them until it came to rest over the place where the child was. Now, I always thought that this was just like an awesome verse. I love it, and it's just so interesting to me. You see, the thing is this, though they went over here and got sidetracked by someone trying to steal their joy, when they went back out, the star was still there. The star was still there. Star hadn't left. The star was still there. Still in that spot waiting for them. So I just wonder. You ever been there? You say, Pastor, what are you talking about? Been where? Get sidetracked. Satan wants to sidetrack you. He wants you to lose focus. He wants you to think about things that really are not really important at the moment. But I promise you this. Now what? When finally the Lord's like, whoa, 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 whoa. Don't do that. Don't do that. And we're like, oh, yeah, I don't want to lose focus. You know what happened? The star's still there. He's still there. And He keeps leading us into the place that we need to be. You see, we have to continually do what the wise men did. We continually seek the Savior of the world. Verse 10 would tell us this. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. What? Satan will always try to beat you down if you slip up. Satan will always, he'll always try to say, no, 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 look at what you missed, look at what you didn't get, look at what you didn't, because Satan is always, right? Satan is one that always brings down. He never lifts up. Always brings down, trying to get people to the bottom of where he is at. But the thing about it is this, we rejoice with exceedingly great joy because the star is always there. There, watch this. He says, come unto me, all who are heavy. All these things will be given unto you. We look at this. Why? Because he's overcome the world. So we get to this place, and we realize that the star is still there for us. What? You get sidetracked, he's still there. You come back to it. Watch it. Even if you have sin in your life, you know what to do? Repent, and the star's still there. These are the things that he wants to do for us. Verse 11, here's what I want us to look at. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. They fell down and worshiped him. You know what they've been doing? They had been seeking the whole time to do what they did at the end. They lived this whole time frame to do exactly what they did at the end. Did you go back? Their plan was to do it from the beginning. What? They didn't go in and then just all of a sudden be like, oh, now we need to do it. No, no, they knew what they were going to do. Can I ask you, do you know what you're going to do? You got out of bed this morning. Do you know what you're going to do when you got here? We know the right answer. My question is, did you do it? No. The last thing we should ever want to do is have to be forced to do something that should be a privilege. Other countries don't get what we get. You meet like this in China, you won't be meeting next week like this unless they shoot you dead. You don't meet in public over there. Underground churches is what they'll have. Ooh, boy. You know what they do when they wake up in the underground church? You ever talk to the missionaries that have been sent over to China? You know what they do when they do it? Watch this. The people that wake up can't wait to get to church. They can't wait to worship. They can't wait to bow down as soon as they get in. Oh, maybe because they realize it's a privilege to do what they do. You see, I want you to realize this morning that if you came in thinking that you had the gift, God's not worried about your gifts this morning. He's not worried about how well you dressed this morning. He's not worried about how you smell this morning. Some people may move away from it. He's not worried about how well you smell. He's not worried about if you've held your Bible the right way in your hand at the 90-degree angle so that nothing falls out of it. He's not worried about those things. He's not worried about how much your tithes and offerings are that you have put in. You say, well, Pastor, if you came for that reason, you've missed the point of Christianity. He's not worried about who you know. He's not worried about your connections. He's not worried about any of that that has taken place. But I can tell you what he is worried about. He's worried about, are we doing exactly what these wise men did when they came into the presence of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and it says they worship. My question is, have we worshiped this morning? Now, I can already tell by the answer. I can sense it. Man, y'all are waiting for the food. It'll pull people out when you say you got food. Just ask Jesus. And then he turns around and looks at the crowd and said, the only reason you're following me is because I fed you, and they all walked away. Oh, we'll feed you this morning. I hope you don't walk away. That wasn't the only reason you came. It is early. Good gracious, it's almost lunchtime. Some of us been at work for 6 hours. I don't, it's just my question to you is this: how'd you come worshiping today? Some of you all drug yourself out of bed, not because you's feeling bad, because there's something on the table in there. Lord, help us that we have to drag ourselves out of bed to come to church because church is not interesting enough that we're going to meet Jesus Christ, the Savior of the world, together. And yet we say this, I can't wait to get together in heaven together. Can't even get you to church together. Oh, me. Now I'm saying that the reason that we don't have joy is because we do things for the wrong reason. Well, I did. You say, Pastor, you just preach too hard. You do all this. Well, guess what? The ones that are saying that ain't got no joy to start with. You missed everything. You think I preach too hard? You never met John the Baptist. You ain't ever read it. You think I preach too hard? You ain't read Paul's letters. No, I promise you, I'm a sissy compared to the preachers in the Bible. I promise you I am. Why? Because I've read it. Ooh, boy, they're good. They convict me. Man, it's good stuff. You say, well, Pastor, why do you say some of the things? I had somebody send me a letter like that one time, didn't even put their name on, but they want to know, why do you say some of the things that you say? Because we're too comfortable in the way that we are. And we've been lulled asleep by nobody ever telling the truth. And so what happens is we think if somebody comes in and says God is love, that's enough to get us to heaven, because at one time, watch it, one time we worship God and now we live our life the rest of the way. Pastor, don't you come visit me because I want to live my life the way I want to. I'm not going to come to your house because I want to live my life the way I want to. And if I get around you, you talk about Jesus too much and I can't handle that. Then all of a sudden we look at this and we try to figure out, why are things not going good? Well, it's got to be the pastor. Oh, really? The reason you ain't got joy has got nothing to do with me. Watch this. Watch this. Tommy, you can do something that absolutely just lay me out. You can't take my joy. Right? Can't nobody in here take our joy. But you can sure give it up. Somebody hurt your feelings, get over it. They nailed Jesus to a cross. He got over it so much, watch this, that he saved them. Come on. You say, Pastor, where are we going with this? I said, we focus too much on everything else. And when we neglect, as Jesus would say, the weightier things, and we come in and we miss the sense of worship, what it truly is. You want to have real joy? You got to worship first. You see, I asked, what did you bring today? I asked maybe, what did you have? What came? What is going to be here? What are these things? Can I ask you, are you worshiping Him? That's the only thing that matters. Did you walk in the door ready to worship? Did you get out of bed ready to worship? Did you drive ready to worship? Did you do all these things ready to worship? Because worship is the key. Worship is what really is going to make the difference. I promise you. The difference was not that they brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The difference was, watch this, they carried that all the way there. But that wasn't the difference. It wasn't that Jesus looked at that. He was a baby, right? He was 2 years old. So he looked. There's no way that he looked at it and said, thank you for bringing my gifts. No. No. Because it had nothing to do with the gifts. It had to do with what they already knew what they had to do, which was worship. What did you bring with you this morning? What do you have to offer Him? Because I'll go ahead and tell you, the greatest that it is, Paul says, is filthy rags compared to who He is. You see, He just wants our worship. You got $5 in the bank, He wants your worship. Right? You got a $1,000 suit on, He wants your worship. It don't matter about all those things. It doesn't matter about that part of it. We have to worship the King of Kings and the Lord of all. Some this morning have came, and you're bearing some stuff. But the problem is, it ain't the right stuff. It ain't the gifts. You're bearing the weight of the world that you had to deal with this week. Why? Because Satan's tried to trip you up. Satan's tried to get you to lose focus on those things. I promise you, I understand as a pastor, you can lose focus. And you can do it all in the name of Jesus. But we can still lose focus. See, it's not the gifts for the Savior. but it's the things of life that are weighing you down, that he'll never receive the gift. You say, what are you talking about, Pastor? Well, what happens is this. Some have brought in the things that you can't worship the Lord with. You say, what are you talking about, Pat? I'm talking about sin. Can't worship the Lord with sin in your life. He won't accept it. He actually, Scripture says, won't accept it if you have something against your brother or your sister. And even if you make it all the way to the altar with your gift, he says he won't accept it until you make things right. Ooh. Ooh. Some have brought you guilt this morning. Tough week. Some maybe have brought pride. Some maybe have brought alcohol. Some maybe have brought smoking. Some maybe have brought all the secrets that you've been carrying around. You might say, well, Pastor, are you trying to ask me how do I worship God like this? No, because you don't worship God like that. Pastor, are you asking me how do I have joy like this? No, you don't have joy like this. You can't have it. If you brought anything else other than your worship, then you missed it. I just wonder, as they come up, they're going to play this morning. There's a story that was told of an African village one time. And in that African village, revival had broke out like one they had never seen of where they were. People were coming from very far distances because they had been hearing about the things that were happening at that revival. They came saying that they wanted what the overflow was of the joy that these people had coming out of those services. There were some people that were sent by a missionary that were there as well. The missionary had just talked to them and tried to help them out and sent these over to this revival that was going on. And these were sinners. And these were heathens, if there ever were any. And they were unmoved by the meetings that took place. But later on after that, they were awakened through the power of the Holy Spirit that was speaking into their lives. And when asked, watch this, when asked what they really wanted for God to do for them, all they replied was this: the Christians have an overflowing joy. We want God to give us that joy. Can I ask you today, if I would have shook hands with you before church started, would I have sensed the overflowing joy? If I talked to you before we went to Sunday school class in between, would you have told me you had the overflowing joy? Can I ask you this? Would my spirit have borne witness with your spirit that I would have known that you've got that overflowing joy? You see, here's the thing. You say, Pastor, we've been through a lot this week, and you're asking us to come and show up and really be ready to worship. But you don't understand what we went through. Come on up here, and we'll walk through it together, because you don't know what I've been through either. 32 hours of no sleep. Anybody else going on that? Yet I came this morning, Curtis. You know why I came? Not because of you. What? Do you realize that? I didn't mean to hurt your feelings. I didn't come because of Curtis. I come because I wanted to worship Jesus. You say, well, Pastor, you got to preach. No, I'll just call somebody and they fill in for me. My My job is to worship Jesus. My kids have been sick 4 weeks straight. Flu, and then Joy in the emergency room twice within 6 hours. My wife is going on about 4 weeks of none sleep. See, so many times we just say, well, the pastor's got it easy. He's just got to come in and do this. No, I'm not saying that. But I make a choice to worship Jesus. You see where my wife's at today. You know what would have been the easiest thing to do? Been the easiest thing. But in my house, you know what we do? We serve the Lord. You say, well, Pastor, we don't want you to bring no sickness. We're not bringing any sickness. If you're afraid of sickness, you ain't going to get around nobody this time of season. But the thing about it is this, that what I'm wanting you to understand. You say, Pastor, you're just trying to tell us how hard of a week you've had. No, I'm not up here complaining about my week. I'm telling you how much praise I've got that he's touched my children. Aren't you? It was bad enough. We could have still been in the hospital, Peggy. Joy was that sick. She could have been there. But you know what my God did? My God said, no, let me touch her. Y'all don't have to stay here. And say, he's playing this song, right? You playing that song, man. That's great, man. You just had a... Thing about it is this. Me and my wife, I already told you. How many were here Wednesday night? You remember what I said Wednesday night? I choose not to complain anymore. We don't want to complain, do we? Complaining never solved anything. But praise changes all of our situations. So we sat in that emergency room. Joy hurting, doing everything. Doctors couldn't really do a lot at the time. So what we did, said, Pastor, what do you do? I'm just trying to help you understand you're not the only one going through something. Other people go through it. I'm not the only one going through something. My wife's not the only one. My kids are not the only one. But neither are you. And what we do is we come, watch this, we come to church not bearing the weight of the world because of the week we had, but we come saying, I just want to worship Jesus the way he is, because he changes everything. He changes the way I look at sickness. Has he ever? I promise you, you want to hear some stories? Come talk to me and my wife, and we'll talk to you about the way God changed our vision of what sickness really looks like. Quit giving Satan all the glory and praise. Start lifting up the name of Jesus even in the tough times. Even in the hard times, he's still good. He's still God. He is still the one that can do all things, and he does those well. And so what we do is we say this, you know what? I'm not going to have to try to put my feet on the floor on Sunday morning and figure out if I'm going to church. Why would I even want to even think about that? I just want to go worship him. Well, Pastor, you don't know who's at church. That's the reason I don't want to go to church. No, that's a spiritual problem. You say, well, Pastor, it's your preaching. That's a spiritual problem. I wonder what the wise men really encountered along their way. It was just simple, easy journey, nothing wrong. Just had a great time. You know, Paul's life was like that. Paul never went through anything. Paul got transformed by the power of Jesus Christ, and God says this, let me just make a gold pathway for you to heaven, and you'll never have to endure anything, Paul. If you read that in Scripture, you got a different Bible than I got. You say, what are you talking about, Pastor, when it comes down to saying this? The only reason you ain't going to get anything is because you didn't come prepared to worship. It's all about our worship. It's not about anything else we have. It's about our worship. So how are you worshiping today? Are you looking for joy? You can't have it unless you worship first. Because there's going to be times, we talked about in Sunday school, joy is a feeling. There's going to be sometimes I feel like I really don't have joy, but that doesn't mean that God ain't real. And so what I'm going to do, I'm still going to praise him, even though I may not feel like it at the moment. I can promise you, Paul and Silas in shackles and chains, after they'd been beaten, sitting in a prison, and at midnight, they were praying and singing psalms, and then God moved. You know why? Because they had the joy. This morning, you want to see God do something in your life? Guess what? Quit being sorry for yourself and start saying this. I'm going to worship God more than I feel sorry for myself. And I'm going to lift my voice up to him, and I'm going to praise him no matter what, because he's greater than anything I've ever experienced in my life. And so I wonder, are you ready to do that this morning? Are you ready to do that? Listen, if you came for any other reason, all that can be changed right now. And you can say, you know what? Maybe I did, but I don't want to live my life like that anymore. I want every day to be a place to where I come and I just worship him daily. At my work, in my home, at church, I always wanted to be about Jesus Christ. I want to worship him. I want to seek him because he's good. He's good. Yes, times are tough, but he's good. Yes, times are hard, but he's good. Yes, people struggle, but he's good. And I promise you, you lift up the name of Jesus when the world is saying that you should be just falling apart, they'll be wanting what you got. They will. My question is just going to be, how are you right now? Right now. Watch this. Jesus Christ coming. Splits the eastern skies. You going to heaven? Now watch this. Watch this. If you say anything other than, yes, I know beyond a shadow of a doubt, you ain't ready. You say, well, Pastor, how can you say that? Why? There can be no doubt. You got to know that you know that you know that no matter what happens, I'm seeing him. Every day of your life, you live your life in a way that says, if he comes right now, I'm ready. If he comes right now, I'm ready. When I lay my head down at night and I go to sleep, I don't wake back up, I'm ready. If I wake up in the morning, I get on the bus and I'm driving it, I'm ready. No matter what happens. Watch it. We live in a fallen world. Things are getting closer to home. We're in small town Lancaster. Lancaster is a place that, well, we would say it's pretty safe. I promise you, there's coming a day it ain't going to be safe, Mike. It ain't going to be safe. My question to you is this. Are you ready? He comes right now. Are you ready? He comes right now. You going with him? He comes right now. Do you know? How did you come this morning? You ready to worship him? That's what we'll do for all eternity is our worship. He's looking at our worship. Who cares about anything else that we got? I wish I could pull out money, Curtis, but I ain't got none. You see what I got? That's about what it's limited to. Woo-hoo! There you go. But the thing about this, who cares if I even had that? I got Jesus. And I choose to worship him. I choose to worship him. Man, we're coming up on this Christmas season. What we'll say is Christmas Day. I choose to worship him today. I ain't waiting till then. I choose today. Tomorrow's coming. I choose today. Next week's coming. I choose today. Today is the day. Are you ready for it?